Thank you for inviting me. It's a pleasure to be among you for this 25th anniversary, and among all the friends of the Dystonia Society. My talk will be devoted to physiotherapy, but especially physiotherapy for cervical dystonia. And I will share my presentation in two parts. The first part is more theoretical about the basis of the physiotherapy. Then the second part will be more practical, and I ask a patient of the audience to participate at a mini session of rehabilitation. If we read the definition of cervical dystonia in general and cervical dystonia, we have some cue about the rehabilitation, because the dystonia is a problem of posture. And do you have a point?
Yes.
Thank you.
So here the right button.
Yes, thank you. Is a problem of posture and a problem of movement. And probably if you observe the motricity is not unique, and you have to divide the motricity in these different aspects, such as posture, tonic activity, and movement, phasic activity. And the rehabilitation has to focus on this aspect. Rehabilitation is not a new concept. And since the beginning of the 19th century, many neurologists presented different options of rehabilitation. And to treat abnormal movement disorder by a correct, well-adapted, well-conducted movement has always been an option in the treatment of dystonia. And probably the most important technique was presented at this time by Brissot and Meige, the psychomotor treatment, where the patient has to be his own actor of rehabilitation. He has to be to participate at the treatment. It's probably this is one of the main points you have to keep in mind of this time. But the beginning of the rehabilitation was with the behaviorist, when they proved that voluntary control can modify the severity of cervical dystonia. It's possible the patient has the power to reduce the severity of the dystonia. It is a departure of the modern rehabilitation. Presently, in the review of the literature, which are the technique the most efficient, probably the connection between movement and botulinum toxin. Relaxation of the overactive movement and activation of the underactive muscles. Feedback is in the same way of treatment. If you observe the patient, you observe the different features of cervical dystonia, and this posture is due to the resultant of the different muscular force on the neck. And we have to observe to find exactly which are the muscle involved in the modification of the posture. If in a study sponsored by Amadis, we are looking for the line of force which act on the cervical dystonia. And there is around 78 line of force which act on the cervical dystonia, some in one side, other in other side, and the combination create the posture of the cervical dystonia. And if we observe the function of the different muscles involved, some are the agonists, the muscles which are injected by the neurologist. Others are the antagonist muscles, the muscles which are the object of rehabilitation. Some other muscles are to stabilize the head. Others are to fix, example, the scapula when you move your head. You have a combination of active, passive, and control muscle. It's a very complicated combination of action on the neck. We have to add another point, is other mechanic action, and example the gravity. People who suffer from anticollis or lateralis has the effect of the gravity on the neck, and this increases the abnormal posture of the head. And we have to keep in mind all this action in order to build the rehabilitation program. And in fact, when the patient is in resting position, it's the balance, the equilibrium between all these forces on the neck. And the difficulties for the patient is to escape to this posture and to activate the muscle, and always this equilibrium gain against the post again gain against the ability to reduce. And it's very difficult, and there is some solution I'll show you later. To resume, in fact, there is two main mechanisms which produce the abnormal posture: the contraction of the dystonic muscle, the muscle injected by the neurologist, and a lack of selective activity of the corrective muscle. And if you observe this patient, the sternocleidomastoid, the right sternocleidomastoid is overactive, and this one is underactive. And probably, if you inject this one, you have to develop the ability to contract the antagonist muscle. And if we can't resume the dystonia to one muscle, it's a combination of muscle. It's a movement disorder and not a muscle disorder. Another point, when the patient has an overactivity, like this one, there is a dominance of the tonic movement on the phasic movement, and the patient can move the head slowly, but he can move the head faster, because the tonic activities is the main problem of the dystonia, and the phasic activity is not concerned by the dystonia in the majority of cases. And we can develop the ability to move the head rapidly in order to modify the posture of the patient. The overactivity is responsible of the lack of mobility. And if you observe the rotation of a patient, frequently the range of motion is reduced when the patient turns the head to the opposite side to the dystonia. And usually the rotation is the main problem, but the other plan of movement can be involved too. I show you, it's a study in progress with the sponsoring of Amadis, the Bruegel Prize of the previous Bruegel Prize. And we study each vertebrae during the posture, resting posture when sitting, then when the patient is moving the head to one side, then to the other side. And if you see this patient, when sitting in a resting position, the head, this one is C1, the atlas vertebrae, the C1, which support the head. This one is just the tooth of the C2, the axis vertebrae, and the atlas turn around the axis like that, and the head is supported by the atlas, and when the atlas turns, the head turns like that. And you can see for this example, the patient when he is when he's sitting, the face is here, the nape of the neck, the back of the head is here, and he is turning to the left. He can turn when resting. When he turns to the left, the movement is easy, and when he turns to the right, he has almost no range of motion. And it's possible to observe each level, each vertebrae, and each posture, frontal, axial, and coronal. The main point for the rehabilitation, in my opinion, the main point is impersistence or the functional muscular deficit of the corrective muscle. You can see this lady when she's on the back, the head, she tried to bend the head forward. And you have a contraction of the right sternocleidomastoid, but the left is completely inactive. And probably the objective of the rehabilitation is to focus on the possibility to modify and to activate this muscle in order to be a complementary treatment of the botulinum toxin injection. There is few description in the literature, medical literature, about this effect on the antagonist muscle. But there is a Japanese publication, and it's the case of a right spasmodic torticollis. And here, when you turn to the right, the left sternocleidomastoid is active. This one is normal. But the right sternocleidomastoid has to be completely relaxed. In fact, in the dystonia, this muscle is active. In the contrary, when the patient turns the head to the other side, the right sternocleidomastoid has to be active, but in fact, there is a complete silence on the EMG. So probably, if we find a solution to activate this muscle, we modify the severity of the dystonia. So the rehabilitation is I can resume with this image. Rehabilitation is a combination of relaxation, diminish the tone of the overactive muscle, and to develop the possibility to contract the corrective muscle. But this activation has to be slow on a low level of activity in order to prevent the overspread overflow, thank you, Marie, the overflow in the dystonic muscle. So the ordinary procedure for progressing on modifying the severity of the dystonia is firstly to be very active every day to modify the abnormal posture. It's a everyday self-training. To be very precise on the corrective muscle, to have a very selective corrective contraction, to begin in the position with the less dystonia reaction when lying on the back, then when sitting, then when standing, and to introduce the correction in the everyday life and the everyday activities. Another point, but I won't develop this aspect, but it's very important, is the perceptive information, the perceptive information, proprioceptive information, are not well adjusted in dystonia, and the patient needs the vision in order to correct the head. And frequently, if the eyes are closed, the patient miss the normal posture of the head. On this point, you have to develop, and we have some possibility, just a light touch or a control of the vision. In fact, the name is an haptic feedback. It's a supplementary information which helps to control the posture. Just is this kind of rehabilitation efficient? It's a study on progress. I use inertial sensor. The inertial sensor gives the information of the three-dimensional movement of the head in space. And the two examples of patients, this lady has an inertial sensor here, and when she moves the head, we have the information of the movement of the head in space. Yeah, she is turning the head like that, the blue line. You see, she turned to the left, she turned to the right, she turned to the left, she turned to the right, and you have the other movement when she turned, the flexion and the flexion in the sagittal plane and the flexion in the frontal plane, and you can see if the patient moves the head in the other plane. And if you observe this lady, she turned to the left, she turned to the right, she turned to the left, she turned to the right, and when she is turning to the right, the result is not very good because she has some movement like that. So she trains, she performs a specific movement or rotation. She turns during 20 minutes, and after that, you can see how the movement is more fluid, more correct. Another example, this man. He was presented at the Paris Dystonia Europe Congress. And this man, when he turned to the left, is normal. He can turn to the right. He tried, but he can't barely. You can see the movement like that. He turned to the left, easy. To the right, impossible. To the left. And he go in a room, side to the laboratory. He trained to turn the same exercise. He turned during 20 minutes. And after training, you can see he can turn to the left and to the right. Not perfectly, but it's possible to modify the movement by the repetition. The problem is to maintain this correction. So the patient has to train many times per day, not too long, a short time, but many times in order to have the habit to turn the head to the opposite side. And the patient is the main actor of his rehabilitation. Just 5 minutes for I show you how I can organize the rehabilitation. I will show you one or two things. Just describe Jan, the problem of Jan. Jan present is suffering from a spasmodic torticollis, a tonic and clonic spasmodic torticollis. The hand is bone is bent forward and is turned to the left. And probably when you bend your head backward, extend your head. He has a shift, and a rotation. And can you turn the head to the right? It's very difficult because the low and the low movements are more difficult. Can you turn? Excuse me. Can you say no? Faster. Say me no. When the movement is fast, it's not difficult to turn the head to the right. It's because you have to change. If you turn the neck of, if you activate the muscle of your neck, you increase your spasmodic torticollis. If you focus your attention on your face, and you displace your attention on your face, you reduce your dystonia on the reaction of the of your muscle. And say just turn slowly the head to me, okay. And I will say no. And you, another point, can you follow my finger? Follow my finger. No difficulties. Follow your finger, yours. If you use the vision, it could be an. You have to displace the problem from the neck to the face and don't focus your attention on the problem. It's possible. Just I have to stop.
No.
Oh no, I have time. Okay. the first point is to modify the way to move your head. On this man, you explain you are a motorbiker,
yes.
And you don't have any problem when you drive your.
I go to my work every day on my motorbike, so big motorbike, and. I have no difficulties on the road, but for other things, I have difficulties. But with motorbike, no problem. So when people say, oh, you come to motorbike and you are a disabled people, yeah.
In fact, it's because when you are driving your motorbike, you are biking, you move your head very fast and you don't have any difficulty at the crossroad or when you pass the car, and it's you have to change the kind of movement, the specific aspect of the movement from the tonic to the physique. The other point, your head is like that because it's an equilibrium between an overactivity of your extensor. Can you look at the roof? If you do that, or bend forward, like the when you are the head bending like that, your extensor are relaxed. But if you do that, you increase the tone of the muscle because you activate the dystonic muscle. On the other point of the rehabilitation is to modify the action of the muscle. And one way is to just put your chin on your throat very slowly and to extend, to relax, and to activate. Probably there is a lack of activation of two small muscles on the anterior part of the vertebrae, the longus coli muscles. And this longus coli muscle reduce the low doses of the cervical region. And if you activate here, put your chin here, the chin here, relax. And you have to train this muscle. You have difficulty, relax. Turn, and maintain. And probably you have to activate this muscle because if you stay with the head like that, you always stimulate the dystonic muscle. And you have to move the action from the dystonic to the weak muscle. Turn to the right, turn to the left, to the right. The extension is not good. And probably this posture is an equilibrium. And we need you receive an injection here, probably. Yeah. Only you need injection here because these muscles are too active. Then the complementary action of the rehabilitation is to train the corrective muscle, such as the longus coli and the longus coli and sternocleidomastoid. For that, you have to practice this exercise to reduce the low doses to do the double chin exercise, like that. And relax. We are sitting is not good because the first time I met Jan, but if you start, where lying on the back and you replace your head, extend the dystonic muscle, relax, and just maintain the head in good posture. Then progressively you bend forward in order to activate the corrective muscle. No strains, no stretch, just placement without, nothing could be painful, just very pleasant movement. And if you turn, when you turn to the right, is pleasant to turn, no? Yeah. It's relaxing to move the head to the corrective muscle. And you have to practice that very frequently during the day in order to modify your habitual posture. Turn, and now to alone. Forget me, turn your head. Everything has the possibility to modify the movement. The worst thing is to battle again, to fight again the dystonia. You have to escape and control the corrective muscle. Maybe I will stop for now.